Hello, here I am again. Still in Florida, as you can see. I haven't got back to Pennsylvania. We're going to get back there soon. And I've got my brown shirt on again, which means I'm going to be talking about the Quran again. And we want to finish off this whole thing with the Qira'at and the Akhruf, these different dialects or these different readings or these different transmitters, these Rawis or Riawat. And these are fascinating because when you look and see what we're now finding out, it's amazing because I thought there was always only supposed to be one Quran. Remember, that's what we started out with. And then it jumped to 7 and then jumped to 10. And it hold on a minute. I'm probably confusing you because some of you probably don't know what I'm talking about. So let's review. Let's go back. Let's go back to my PowerPoint that I had introduced over a week ago. And let's review what we're talking about and try to get back on page again so that we can see where we're going to go with this. Okay, hold on. Come with me. Now, the question is, were there more than 30 rawis? Rawis means transmitters, between 736 and 936. Now, I'm probably confusing you, you can't remember, so let's do a review of what we talked about last week. Do you remember this? Remember the timeline that I gave up? Remember these 10 readings that you see here in green and in red? The 7 green ones, those are the ones that are considered to be the 7 readings that supposedly came from Muhammad, who is right down here, who dies in 632. And we know now that these are not those, because look at the dates. Muhammad died in 632. These guy, the very first one to write his down is Ibn Amir from Damascus. He dies in 736. Then comes Ibn Kathir from Mecca. He dies in 738. Asim from Kufa. He dies in 745. Abu Amir from Basra. He dies in 770. Hamza from Kufa. He dies in 772. Nafi from Medina. He dies in 785. And Al-Kasai from Kufa. He dies in 805. So none of these people were living at the time of Muhammad. They weren't even doing their work in the same century Muhammad was living. So you can see these are not those 7 that supposedly Jibril gave to Muhammad while he was still living. These are the 7. These are the only Qurans. These are the first Qurans. These are the first Qira'at. These are the first readers that we have access to. And that's why you can buy theirs. There, you can still buy those. That's Hatun has bought hers. And these are well available, easily available on the internet. I just ordered 7 of them last week. So these are the first 7. However, they were chosen by Ibn Mujahid in 936, so that's almost 200. In fact, it is 200 years later. That's in the 10th century for those that were being written down in the 8th and 9th century. Another 3 were then added. Those are the red ones, Abu Jafar from Medina, Yaqub from Basra, and Khalaf from Kufa. And they were added by Al-Jazari. Remember Al-Jazari? He died in 1429. So that's the 15th century. That is 800 years after Muhammad. So none of these guys could certainly have been living at the time of Muhammad. No, these are the 10. These are the creme de la creme. These are the best of the best. And then we talked about that there were others that came here. Because you notice, what's missing? What's missing here? What do you see missing here? Well, you can see the 2 names that should be there. Where is Warsh and where is Hafs? They are the ones that should be there, right? Because they are the ones that whose Quran we have today. This is the Quran that I use everywhere I go, and this is the Hafs Quran. This is the Quran that was chosen in 1924. Where is that in that list? Take a look at that list. Do you see it there? I can't see it. And I mentioned this last week. We need to know where Hafs is. Well, Hafs is brought in here. Remember this? These are the 20 narrators that were ascribed to every one of these 7 readers. Each one of those readers was given 2. And these 2 were chosen. Well, the first 14 were chosen by Ibn Mujahid for those 7. And then the other 6 were chosen by Al-Jazari for the other 3. Making 20. So 20 narrators, or rawis, or transmitters, or students, or those who come on the line of each one of the original 10. So that means we have a total of 30. 30. And when I left you a week ago, I said there were only 30 of them. And that's what there are 30 official readers, official transmitters, official rawis, official students. These are 30 official qira'at Qurans, as I used to call it. I wish that were true, but that's not true. Guess what? There were more, quite a few more, many, many more. So let's go and see what we're talking about. And to do that, let's go to Shadi Hekmat Nasir. Shadi Hekmat Nasir wrote back in 2012, The Transmission of the Variant Readings of the Quran, published by Leyden and Brill. And I'm just going to look at pages 144 to 156. You can go and read that there and see what he says, because he then goes in and explains it. And what we need to know is that there was an awful lot of sophistication going on into how these different readers, how their different transmitters. What we do know is this, that between the time that the initial 8th century reader, Ibn Amr al-Damask, 736, he's the earliest one, and between the time that he created his Qira'at Quran, and the 10th century, when the original seven readers were appointed by Ibn Mujahid, so that's that intervening 200 years, between this time, we now know that in those 200 years, there were many other transmitters, known as rawis, or students, or narrators. So that intervening 200 years, there was lots more that were actually writing Qurans down. And they come into many different families. And this is a huge, huge, you'll hear Muslims talk about this all the time. And they always get berate me, because they, you have no idea what you're talking about. You don't know what you're talking about. There's whole schools that actually looked at all these different rawats, and these rawis, and the rawiyat, who then chose these different people, and these 20 were chosen for a reason, and they were all chosen with an enormous amount of science, very sophisticated science. And Nasir agrees with that. There was a very sophisticated science, which is interesting, because all of this happens after the 8th century. None of this happens before that. It all happens after the 8th century. And it is very sophisticated. You're right. But how many of these are we talking about? Well, what we now know is there were so many that it caused a crisis. And because there were so many of these reciters and transmitters and narrators and rawis who were writing down from these different schools, these 10 different schools in 5 different cities, Mecca, Medina, and Basra, and Kufa, and Damascus, these 5 different cities, because there were so many of them, that they had a crisis. They needed to choose just what we're now told today is 2 amongst them, right? Well, let's review what we've already done. So you have the 10 readers, you have the 20 narrators, giving us a total of 30, but he wasn't alone. Hold on a minute. Ibn Mujahid and Al-Jaziri, they weren't alone. There were, especially Ibn Mujahid. Let's take a look and see what we now found. There were other scholars besides Ibn Mujahid, other scholars who were also choosing narrators, or who were also choosing those who were considered to be authoritative. Let's look here at Al-Dani, died in 1053. He had a completely different list of rawis, or transmitters, than Ibn Mujahid. For Nafi, he had 4 rawis. For Ibn Amir, he had 5 rawis. For Asim, he had 4 rawis. For Al-Kisai, he had 5 rawis. Ibn Kathir, he gave 3 rawis, and for Amr, he gave 2 rawis. Hamza, he just gave 1. Take a look at that. That's not 2, 2, 2, 2, 2 like you have at Ibn Mujahid. 4, 5, 4, 5, 3, 2, 1. How many do you get? A total of 24 rawis, or transmitters, or narrators. That's 10 more than Ibn Mujahid. In between the 8th century, when you have the first of the oldest of the Ibn Amir from Damascus, from Ibn Amir all the way to Ibn Mujahid. So Ibn Amir, between Ibn Amir and Ibn Mujahid, according to Al-Dani, who dies in the 11th century, he's even after Ibn Mujahid, another 100 years, he has 24 rawis, 10 more than Ibn Mujahid. But he's not alone. Let's take a look at another one. Look at this guy. This is Abu Ali al-Maliki. He dies also in the 11th century. He's in 1046. He had a completely different list of rawis than either Ibn Mujahid or even Al-Dani. So for Nafi, he had 4 rawis. For Ibn Amir, he had 2. Asim, he had 2. Al-Kisai, he had 8. Ibn Kathir, 2. Abu Amr, 3. And Hamza, 4 rawis. So how many does that come to? 25 rawis, 25 narrators, 25 transmitters between what we have in Ibn Amir, in 736 and Ibn Mujahid in 936. That's a good 11 more than Ibn Mujahid. So there are all kinds of disagreements. So the question needs to be asked, how did they choose their canonical rawis? How did they choose? How did Ibn Mujahid come to his 2? And how did Al-Dani come to his 24? And how did Maliki come to his 25? 20, 24, and 25. How did they come? How did they make their decisions? Well, what Nasir tells us, and this is something that I remember hearing and I remember reading, and when I was back in my seminary days, they talked about this. And what they would do is they would look at all these different transmitters. There's all these different transmitters, and they would look and see how many transmitters had students under them, and the number of transmitters that had students gave them more authority. So if this many had this many students and this many had 4 or 5 students, he had more authority. And what they would do is they would just choose then who was the most popular. Now, I've always thought that if you're going to do textual criticism of any book, you don't just go to who is the most popular. I've always thought, as we've done with our Bible, you go with which is the earliest. You go with that which is closest to the event, closest to the author who wrote it. So I would suggest I would like to have people who were closest to Muhammad in the 7th century. But we can't, because none of these even begin to appear until the 8th century. Well, then let's go to those who are closest to the 8th century. Why doesn't you go to those texts which were from the 8th century, from their closest to the 7 or the 10? Those who were actually students immediately under them. Why don't you just choose them? No, they don't. They go to those who come after them, who are the most popular. It's all to do with popularity. Well, that's not always true either. Nasir comes and he looks at Nafi, and he looks at particularly, remember, Nafi is from Medina, and Nafi's dates are 689 to 785, so around the late 8th century, he is writing his Quran down, and then he has students underneath him, right, from Medina. So you would assume, well, maybe his students are from Medina, so that's why they were chosen. Now, we do know that according to what we see in the chart, remember the chart that I said you need to get off of Wikipedia? This is one I keep using. When you have Nafi, we knew that he has 2 narrators according to Ibn Mujahid, Khalun and Warsh. Khalun and Warsh. So how did he choose Khalun and how did he choose Warsh? Well, according to Nasir, he chose Khalun because Khalun's from Medina. Bingo. That makes sense to me. And then why Warsh? Well, actually, when you look at Warsh, Nasir said, he doesn't have many students after him. He has very few students after him. And as a result, he wasn't very popular. So he should not have been chosen. So why was he chosen? Well, there were two other narrators that should have been chosen above Warsh. One is called Ismail ibn Jafar, and the other was called Al-Musayyabi. Musayyabi and Jafar. Why weren't they chosen? They had many more students than Warsh had. Well, it turns out there are a number of reasons why Warsh was chosen. One is that Ismail bin Jafar and Al-Musayyabi stayed in Medina along with Khalun. So therefore, there were 3 major transmitters that were there in Medina. There was just two too many. They had to choose one of those 3. Why? I would suggest they chose 2 of them. At least they're closer and they are in the same city that Nafi comes from, and they should have at least been able to catch a little bit of what he said and understand. I mean, what's interesting is their Qurans don't even agree with Nafi. But nonetheless, why Warsh? Why was Warsh chosen? According to Nasir, while Khalun stayed in Medina, good old Warsh moved to Egypt. He didn't stay in Medina. He lived in Egypt, and he was there for 20 years. And Al-Dani, who has another list that comes after, remember he was 1046, he's in the 11th century, he has another list, he puts also Warsh there. And why? Because he went and spent a year in Egypt and studied under one of the reciters of Warsh. And so because of that, affinity, he decided to put Warsh down. And so good old Ibn Mujahid put Warsh down. So the reason that Warsh was chosen was because he lived in Egypt. Had nothing to do with his ability, had nothing to do with whether he had a better Quran or not, had nothing to do with whether his Quran was like Nafi's. In fact, they didn't even compare the 2 Qurans. They were completely different. I mean, when you stop and think of it, it's odd. I've never heard of using this kind of textual criticism. I've never come across this kind of textual criticism. I always thought you always go to that which follows the earliest. If you have like in our biblical text, when you look at the biblical text and you look at a manuscript and then you get another one who copies from it, another one who copies from it, you want to get the ones that are come closest to the original. You want to get those which is as close. If you don't get one that has nothing to do with the original or somebody who lives in another city or who has an awful lot of popularity because the way he writes it is different than the right. I mean, can you see this is completely off the wall. This is not how you do textual criticism. It's how you do Quranic criticism. And so that's why this whole art, this whole methodology that is being used here for the Quran is completely different than anything else that we've done before. And that's why I can see there's such a crisis for Muhammad Hijab. He has a crisis. I can see why Yasir Qadhi, when he went to Yale University, no wonder he had a crisis. Because suddenly he was coming across what real textual criticism is all about and what you need to do whenever you're looking for the most authoritative. Let's move on though, because what we do know is that there were lots of these intermediary rawis. There's lots of these transmitters from which to choose. Well, how many were there? 20? 30? Let's go and see what Nasser. Now I want you to look at this graph here. So take a look at this graph here. This is what Nasser has in his book from 2012. Look at the qira'ats between Ibn Kathir in Mecca, 738, and Ibn Mujahid. So there you have Ibn Kathir there, okay? I've circled him in green. And here you have Ibn Mujahid down at the bottom, 936. So basically there's about almost 200 years between them. Between those intervening 200 years, take a look at all those names. Look at all the graph. Now notice, these are not before Ibn Kathir, these all come between Ibn Kathir and Ibn Mujahid. And which were the ones that were chosen by Ibn Mujahid? Well, he chose Al-Bazi over here and Kunbul. And the reason why is because they had more students behind them, and because they didn't have single strands, neither of them had single strands, and also because of the ones they went before them. And so that's the science that Muslims are talking about. They look at this and they say, look at the sophistication of this science. And I'm saying, who cares if Kunbul and Al-Bazi don't have the same text as Ibn Kathir? I would throw them out because they are not following Ibn Kathir. That's what's important to me. So how many of these different texts, how many of these different Qira'at Qurans, how many of these different written Qurans, because these were all written down, and that's why they are different. They weren't just recited, because you had to write, once you recite it, you then write down what you recite. Take a look, 59 different Qira'at Qurans, 59 different Qira'at Rawi Qurans, all of them written down, 59 of them. I always thought maybe it was just two. Turns out it's much more than two. It's 59 just between Ibn Kathir and Ibn Mujahid. Now let's take a look at another one. Here is Nafi, okay? Nafi. Nafi is from Medina. And there is Ibn Mujahid at the bottom, okay? Take a look at all the different qira'at before, I mean, all the different rawis between them. Now, the two that were chosen, as we just said earlier, are Kalun and Warsh. Those are the two that are chosen, and they are from Medina. But what's interesting, Warsh is not from Medina. He's from Egypt. That's in and of itself a problem. Nonetheless, Ibn Mujahid chooses those two. He could have chosen any of the others. How many are we talking about? We're talking about 63 different qira'at, 63 different rawis or Qurans, all written down. All right, let's try another one. Let's look at, in this case, Abu Amr, okay, from Basra, dies in 770. Ibn Mujahid is down here in 936, okay? Take a look what he has between them. Now, we're talking about 152 years, about 100, and well, it's more than that. We're almost about 170 years between them, okay? Now, take a look at all those names. Every one of those are transmitters. Every one of them are in the family of Abu Amr from Basra. But which are the ones that Mujahid chooses? He chooses Al-Duri and he chooses Al-Susi from 860 and 874. How many could he have chosen? Well, there were 65 different qira'at. That means he could have chosen 63. He only chose those two out of the 65. 63 he did not choose because they were not as popular as the others. Amazing, this whole mess of what we call as science of Isnad. Now let's end with this one. I only have four to go on because that's all I could find from Nasser. Now here's the one for Asim. This is the one that that we get our huffs from, okay? And here's Asim from Kufa, dies in 745. Ibn Mujahid dies in 936. So again, about 190 years afterwards. Now, take a look. I mean, there's so many on this page. So many, you can't even read them. They're too small. I can't even see the names. We do know that he did choose Shu'ba and then also Hafs. And there's the Hafs. That's the one we're looking for. That's the guy that has been chosen at Cairo in 1924 and then was made authoritative for the whole world in 1985. So there you have those two. Well, how many people are there in that graph? 91 different Qur'ans, 91 different Rawi Qur'ans, all written down, folks. 91 of them, goodness sakes. And the only reason they chose these two is because they were more popular. Look at all the strands that come after them. There's a whole spider's web of material that comes after them. That's why they were chosen. Not because they had better Qur'ans, as we're going to find out with Hafs. He shouldn't have chosen Hafs, but that's for the next video to come. Wait till you find out about what we know about Hafs now. They should never have chosen Hafs, and Ibn Mujahid should never have chosen Hafs. Nonetheless, let's continue on. Let's just add these all up now. Conclusions. Qiraats between Ibn Kathir in Mecca and Ibn Mujahid, 59. Qiraats between Nafi in Medina and Ibn Mujahid, 63. Qiraats between Abu Amr in Basra and Ibn Mujahid, 936, 65. And then Qiraats between Asim in Kufa and Ibn Mujahid in 936, 91. Now, total of 278 different possible Qurans were written down between the 8th century and, the 10th century. So we're talking about 200 years. In that 200 years, intervening years, we have just 278 just from those four. But remember, there were seven. So if you want to look at the average of the four is 70, you total them for all the 10 that were there. Remember the 10, if you want to total them all up for 10, that is almost around 700 different written Qira'at Qurans, almost 700 different Qurans that could have existed. Can you then understand why the Muslims are having a crisis of faith? 700 different Qurans, I'm just guessing because I've only seen four of them. I've not seen all 10. There's six more to go, but if already within the four we have 278, you just multiply that for another six and you get around 600 to 700 of these Qiraats, 600 to 700 of these Rawi Qurans, 600 to 700 of these different Qurans, all written down. And the only reason why the 20 were chosen was because of their popularity. Nothing to do with their ability, nothing to do with whether their Quran was any better or any closer to those which they got it from. And to be careful, to be weird, I mean, this is what's odd about it. Even the seven readers and the three that were chosen by Al-Jazari, what was their criteria? Because there's no isnad that goes before them. We don't have any isnad. We don't have any books to look at. We have no writings to look at before 736. Or do we? We do. That's yet to come. But anyways, I just wanted to show you what was happening in that 200-year period between the 8th century and the 10th century, between 736 and 936. And we're getting almost 700 different Qurans. Can you see, folks, why I'm bringing this up? And these Qurans, most of them were thrown away. Only 20 were retained by Ibn Mujahid. There could have been 25 by Al-Dani and Maliki had, I'm sorry, 24 by Al-Dani and Maliki had 25 of them, but no, they went with Ibn Mujahid. Sorry, he only had 20. oh dear. It gets harder and harder to believe when Muslims say there's only one Quran. No, there's not even 7 or 10 or 20 or 30. There could have been as many as 700. Thank goodness they got it back to one. And that one, this one here, wait to hear what we have to say about this Quran. That's next. Okay, this is Jay then. Over and out.